you know, we knew Beefy would miss the Adelaide test, so there was a match before the Adelaide test, and then a few days, and then a test match, and then another sort of break. So, you know, I was getting around about 3 weeks, and we managed to draw the Adelaide test match. I was first change. Great, I was. We had two spinners, two seamers, and we were first change, and it was quite an interesting sort of scenario. James Whittaker played in his first test match there. So we got through that, and then we went to Melbourne.
Well, if you just quickly go back to Adelaide, obviously 100 for yourself.
Oh yeah,
how special was that for you?
I mean, I liked Adelaide, and as I say, it was one of those lovely grounds. It was a good pitch, and again, the boys got off to a great start, and the Aussies had won the toss on that particular occasion, so they got a big score on the board, and it was important that we all sort of got our heads down. Again, Brodie did really well. So enjoyed batting with Brodie for a little while, you know. And Ath, I think, got off to a reasonable start. Unfortunately, got out, but we got through. Everybody sort of chipped in, and we got very close to the Aussie score in the first innings. It was great. Then the Aussies went in again, and we had a few nervous minutes towards the end of the Test match. I think I went in and got naught sort of second ball or something stupid, but it sort of, let's say, peaked down into a sort of draw, lovely flat wicket, didn't really turn that much, great ground to play, good, you know, sort of short square boundaries, but just a lovely place, really enjoyed it down there, and I think, let's say, we then had to go into Melbourne, and very interesting pitch, had a bit of a dilemma about 20 minutes before the start of play. Actually, probably in half an hour, actually. Graham Dilly came up to me and said, "Oh, I'm not fit." Oh, no. Unfortunately, we just played in a match in Tasmania, and both Small and Foster had played, and Dill didn't play because he was resting the knee. And all of a sudden, they had a choice to make. Just sort of 5 minutes before going, they'd have to toss up or something. And, you know, all of a sudden, a quick chat with Mickey, and he said, "Oh, well, who bowled best, do you think?" I said, "I know, would you?" He said, "Gladstone." I said, "Yeah, okay, let's go." So again, you know, the great thing about myself and Mickey, again, we sort of got to where we did, and without too much fuss, and off we went. So Fozzie was very upset, very, very upset. And I remember winning the toss, and I thought, well, we'll have a bowl on this. It was overcast. It looked like it was going to swing, you know, do a bit. And Beefy wasn't really fit, but he wanted to play. He was desperate to play. He saw the wicket, and I think it's one of those wickets where he felt even at sort of 75-80% he could run in and bowl and do something with it. Plus he was Ian Botham, plus it was Australia, and if he was half fit, he was going to try and play. So he did, and so he let Gladstone open the bowling because Beefy wasn't there. So Gladstone bowled the first ball. Well, he bowled the first two or three balls. One went down there, one went down there, and I'm going, "Oh no, I picked the wrong bowler," you know, thinking, "Oh my god." Anyway, finally got the radar right, and the last two in the over went very nicely. And then all of a sudden we started getting wickets, and Gladstone got a couple, and Beefy was, we thought, how long is it going to take him to loosen up, because you could see he was struggling. And I have to say, he bowled the biggest load of pies and got five for that you've ever seen. Gladstone got five for as well. But the big thing was, again, Chris Broad batted on a difficult wicket all the way through, got 100 again. And the good thing was the tail wag, because it was one of those wickets you could get out very early on, and you know, it wasn't going to get any better. And Gladstone actually got some runs, you know, Embry got a few and Gladstone got a few, and yeah, everybody sort of chipped in, and it was that sort of few runs at the end that sort of enabled us to get, oh, I don't know, 150, 160 on, something like that, and we got into them again, and Gladstone got a couple early doors, and Daffy, I think, got a few more, and the spinners bowled well, and we were able to get back. Marshy, Swampy hung around for a little while, Steve Orr did for a little while as well, but we managed to bowl them out without having to bat again. Gladstone caught the ball, deep square leg off Philip Edmonds. Merview slog swept him straight down his throat. Bloody Gladstone threw the ball away. He threw it into the crowd. I'm thinking, Christ, I've been get told of that. And I'm just wondering how many balls Gladstone gave away that was the ball he caught at deep square leg in Melbourne. But again, it was another great team effort. You know, didn't drop any catches, you know, just phenomenal. The fielding was tremendous. There was runouts. There was, you know, great catches. And Bill Athey, again, wonderful fielder anywhere in there, and again set the standard. Philip De Freitas, you know, everybody beefy catching. So it was, again, Jack Richards took two magnificent catches, one running back about 30 yards down to fine leg, and then he caught an underneath edge of Alan Border going sort of the wrong way, and then diving back, catching it low there. So there's so many good things that you can, you know, can keep remembering, and we won by tea time on the third day. It was amazing. Elton John was there, he popped in the dressing room, which was absolutely fabulous.
How did that come about?
Well, Elton was doing a tour down under, and funnily enough, he seemed to be doing tours because we were down in New Zealand the year before, or 2 years before, and he was doing a tour down there, and it seemed like he was following the cricket around. And I think on this particular occasion, he'd had an operation on nodules in the throat, so we'd just seen him do Melbourne with the Melbourne Philharmonic Orchestra. Absolutely unbelievable. After that, he had his nodules done, so he came along to watch the Sydney Test match as well. And he was just around. Beefy and him were obviously very friendly, and so he came down, started squirting champagne around, and I didn't really think, and I squirted some champagne on a very expensive silk suit, which he was pleased about, I have to say. But he was a very good man. He put on some parties for us, and it was just one of those... He was DJ for the night, you know, Elton John, DJ, Beefy's room, celebrate. Well, we didn't leave the hotel room, or the sort of dressing room, till much before sort of 8 or 9 o'clock, I don't think, but it was just a wonderful afternoon. We still had another test match to play, and unfortunately we didn't win the one in Sydney, although it was a great test. It's probably actually one of the more enjoyable test matches, and probably for the crowd, because it went right down to
we
got very close. And there were one or two interesting decisions, you know, it was one of those very nice test matches to play in the fact that there was always something, you know, who was going to win, who wasn't. And I think probably a draw would have been the right result in that particular day, but it didn't work out. We lost, but we'd won the series anyway. And I said at the time, I don't think it was that we were complacent or we wanted to win. And actually Australia played reasonably well. I would say Dean Jones got 170 that match, and he was caught down the leg side off the face of the bat off about when he had about 10 or 12, I think. And you couldn't do this now, but I sort of I took some carrots into Steve Randell, who was one of the umpires, and it wrapped in a serviette and said, better have those, Steve, with your lunch, and just in case you haven't had any. And anyway, I dropped a catch, I think, in that test match, and Steve, through the third umpire, sent them back down and said, Gat, you better have these back, which is magnificent, but you couldn't do that these days. So, you know, the whole sort of atmosphere within a test series was good between the umpires and the players as well. So, just a wonderful series.